Super ultrawide monitors are huge. And if you're looking to get into racing, flight, or space sims, you've probably had your eyes on one of these. But what kind of hardware do you need to actually make that dream come true? Do you need the best of the best to drive one of these behemoths, or can you do it with a potato? Well, we're about to find out some of that right here, right now on Robitech. Usually, I promise that we'll find answers to all of the questions that we ask in our intros, but today's video is a bit different. It's part of a two-part series that we're gonna be releasing into the Robitech Ultimate Super Ultra Wide Guide, which, I mean, is really hard to say even as an acronym. Now, in these videos, we'll be looking at some of the latest super ultrawide monitors to hit the market, talk about the pros and cons of each, look at the hardware needed to drive them, and establish an entry point into the super ultrawide gaming market, world, universe, century, millennia, whatever you wanna call it. So let's start with a basic question just to ensure that we're on the same page here. What is an ultrawide monitor? Every monitor has a resolution that is measured in pixels. Typically, when we talk about monitors, we use terms like 1080p or 1440p. These numbers represent the number of pixels on the vertical axis of a monitor, from the top of the screen to the bottom. But for every 9 pixels on the vertical axis, you have 16 pixels on the horizontal one. That's aspect ratio, 16:9, so that maths out to 1920 by 1080 or 2560 by 1440. Technically, this aspect ratio is referred to as widescreen, but it's essentially the norm by today's standards, so we don't really make a big deal out of it. With ultrawide monitors, the vertical pixels stay the same, but those 16 pixels in the 16:9 get bumped up to 21:9. But that's just one level of ultra. Super, super ultrawide monitors get doubled to 32:9. It's so big that I think we're using like a wide angle lens, or maybe that's just Brian in the other room right there to show just how wide these get. If this is a new concept to you, then you're probably wondering who needs that much monitor. And I'm not gonna lie, it's kind of silly to see these things in person, but it's no less awesome either the moment you start gaming and using these things in the applications that can be really awesome for it. So if you're into racing or flight simulators, that extra space is invaluable. It brings the experience that much closer and makes the immersion so much better. Or if you are into like playing FPS titles or MMO titles that offer an ultra-wide or super ultra-wide experience, having that extra space puts more information on the screen for you as a player to react to quicker. Or I know there's a lot of oars, Michael oars, rowing oars. Maybe your work requires a lot of information on screen. Is super ultra-wide the only way to do it? No, but there is something to be said about having everything in one place. I mean, some of these do things like split screens and all that sort of stuff, and it's super awesome. And when we do a deep dive into guides, with our ultrawide guide, then we'll talk a little bit more about that. Speaking of guides, if you wanna have something else that's all in one place, why don't you go ahead and slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss videos like this one or our part two that's gonna be coming out later in the future. So back to the monitors. This is where we get into the meat and the potatoes. If you wanted to get into using a super ultrawide monitor, what kind of hardware do you actually need to push a bad boy like this? Well, we tested a bunch of GPUs out to answer that question. For science, to get a baseline for performance, we used our Intel Core i7 14700K based AIO test bench with a Zotac TwinEdge OC4070 Super GPU. Again, we're already off to a good start because this is like a $2,100 system. This system represents a modern, I know, people are gonna, get so mad, middle of the ground. People are like, middle of the ground at $2,100? But this thing has options on either side, either with upgrades or downgrades. So someplace right now it down in the middle. Now, in case you're wondering, if you wanted to build this system part for part, it would cost, like I said, $2,100. However, we made a number of decisions for our test bench that would not be necessary for you if you're building the system for yourself. Since there is a ton, and I do mean a ton of information here, we're gonna throw some charts on the screen to show you what we discovered, starting with a comparison between widescreen and super ultrawide. At 1440p, we grabbed average frame rates for a few different titles that natively supported both widescreen and super ultrawide formats. And when comparing the two, the performance hit is not, I really wanna put this down here, it is not insignificant. In cinematically rich titles like Cyberpunk 2077 or highly detailed sim racers like F1 2023, our system took a 45% hit in performance. 45%. For Microsoft Flight Simulator and Everspace 2, that hit was significantly lower at 23%. And for Forza Motorsports, we saw the lowest impact at 17.5%. So what's going on here? Essentially, when using a super ultra-wide monitor, your PC is now pulling double duty when it comes to graphic processing. Now, I know that's an oversimplification, but let's just go with it. At 1440p, your PC is responsible for drawing images at 2560 by 1440 pixels. If you do the math, that is 3.6 million pixels. At a matching super ultra-wide resolution, it's now responsible for producing over 7 million pixels. This is, again, simplification. Here is another way to think about this. With one of our super ultra-wide monitors we use for our testing, the 49-inch Samsung Odyssey OLED G9, we essentially had two 24.5-inch monitors smooshed together. I wish you could do that, like, you know, almost like Play-Doh. It's like, I just take them and they, you know, merge. That's technology that's coming. So, is that it? Are we basically, did we get to the answer already? All we need is a 4070 Super to drive a super ultra-wide monitor? Actually, not necessarily. We tested 9 modern GPUs to get our answer. If the threshold or target is 1440p with performance averages over 60 frames per second at highest setting, most of these modern GPUs hit the mark. However, in games like Cyberpunk, let's be honest, most GPUs below the 4070 Super struggle with ray tracing on Ultra, even with frame generation or fluid motion frames active. F1 2023, that was the next demanding title, with the 4060 barely missing the mark at 50 frames per second, while the RX 7600 struggled at an average of 37 FPS. And in Microsoft Flight Sim, I'm sorry, but that poor 7600 didn't even make it through security to catch the plane. Now, we did try to throw the Intel Arc A770 into the mix. With its 16 gigabytes of VRAM, we thought it could be a ringer. And when we started our testing, it put up some exceptional numbers in Cyberpunk 2077. But our poor A770, after 2 years of heavy testing with it, unfortunately, we think we might have pushed it to the brink, and it shall be mourned. So where does this leave us? Well, the A770 is a solid maybe. We don't really have enough to make a solid recommendation, unfortunately, with the card dying the way it did. The RX 7600, it hit some of the marks, but not all of them. Now here's a question. Would the extra VRAM offered by the 7600 XT have made a difference? Some of it maybe, but how much of a difference is actually really hard to say. So at the modern entry point, that leaves us with the RTX 4060 as probably the lowest you can go as a GPU, right? With anything, if you're willing to do a little setting finessing, both the RX 7600 and the RTX 4060 can hit the threshold. However, if you're gonna play a game like Star Citizen, you're gonna wanna start using at least a 4070 Super. We couldn't get consistent enough metrics to give you a full picture, but on the 4070 Super, we saw around 50 FPS on planet and about 65 to 70 FPS in flight. There is, however, one more piece to the puzzle. And we still haven't officially answered the original question, what about the CPU? How low can you go on that? Well, we didn't quite bust out the limbo stick for this one, but we did build a machine that paired an RTX 4060 with AMD's Ryzen 5 7600X, and the results were surprisingly awesome. We ran full races in Forza Motorsport at an average of 72 FPS. Flight Sim was on par with a 14700K build with an average of 72 frames per second. We were also able to get games like Cyberpunk 2077 to be a bit more cooperative by dropping the settings down to medium and by turning off settings like depth of field, lens flare, and film grain. We saw gains in other titles as well. As for Star Citizen, you probably won't be playing this with this rig anytime soon, unless you like averages of 25 frames per second. We tried to turn down the settings to make it work, but we just couldn't get it into a playable state. And this is an important distinction here. What is a playable state? Honestly, on our budget rig, we were playing games like Helldivers 2, Forza Motorsports, Microsoft Flight Sim, Everspace 2, Destiny 2, and more. And while we had some games averaging at the lowest around 45 to 55 frames per second in super ultrawide at their highest settings, these were still very enjoyable experiences. So with all that in mind, how much would it cost to have a system that can run modern racing and flight sims, as well as modern shooters on an ultra-wide monitor? Well, in our case, we got it to be done for just under $1,200. Like I said, This PC pairs a Ryzen 5 7600X with an RTX 4060. We also put in 32 gigs of Patriot Viper Venom DDR5 RAM running at 6000 megatransfer. We have 2 terabytes of Patriot Viper VP4300 Lite Gen 4 NVMe storage. We have an MSI B650 Gaming Plus Wi-Fi motherboard. We're cooling it with Deepcool's AK620 Zero Dark CPU cooler. This is all inside a Fractal Designs Meshify C case. It's got a 650 watt MSI PSU and 4 Noctua NF-A12 fans to keep the air moving. In other words, it's not really a Robitech spare no expense rig, but it is also no Robitech russet potato build either. This recommendation comes with a few considerations. Thing number one, just be aware that this is a budget or entry point build that may not be a long-term solution depending on the games you're gonna play. If you're willing to spend a little bit more money out of the gate to make this dream a reality, on Robitech, we have a ton of builds that have 14700Ks and 7800X3Ds with 4070 Ti Supers or 4080 Supers, etc., that are going to last a bit longer than the budget build we just talked about. However, the benefit of our budget build is that it does have room to grow. You could spend a couple hundred dollars on a CPU or GPU upgrade with a matching PSU upgrade that could set you for a long time. And also, going with an AMD CPU offers a bit more longevity since AMD is going to be supporting AMD for a few more releases. Just look at the budget, look at all the builds we have on Robitech.com or here on the Robitech YouTube channel, and you can probably find something that fits within your budget, knowing where you are at a baseline, knowing you need at least a 7600X and a 4060. Thing number two, and we say this all the time, and we're going to say it again, there is no one-size-fits-all tech solution. The Radeon GPUs we tested did really well in most titles, and there are a lot of ultra-wide games that AMD GPUs thrive in. When you consider that you can scoop up an RX 7800 XT for less than a 4070 Super, it's a compelling alternative. Please, please don't let benchmarks for games like Cyberpunk or Star Citizen dissuade you from considering an AMD GPU. We tested these titles as outliers, fully aware that Star Citizen is friendly to no PC at all. That game is going to be tested and in development forever, and that Cyberpunk is a brutal benchmark on any GPU and heavily favors Nvidia. And honestly, there aren't many games like this on the horizon at the moment. So it would be worth your time to do a little extra research to see which GPU favors the games you want to play in ultrawide. Games like COD really love AMD, and racing sims like F1 2023 and Forza Motorsport were competitive too. But there are definitely more titles out there that thrive on AMD. So Nvidia isn't your only option. That's not to say that Nvidia is bad. I'm just saying that you can look at both sides and probably maybe save some money if you don't necessarily need ray tracing, etc. To wrap all of this up in one pretty bow, when it comes to the type of system you'll need, if you want to play super ultra-wide monitor games successfully, it can be done even with modest components. However, if you have a system that's, say, for instance, a generation behind, you can use our data as a good comparative guide on how your system may actually handle these monitors. We'd recommend that you do some benchmarking of your system and knock an average of 30 to 40% off of the top just to be safe. If the results fall within an acceptable threshold for you, make the plunge. Gaming on a super ultra-wide monitor is a stunning experience, especially if you're really into the games that, I don't know, just really thrive from a monitor like this. But if you're looking at building a modern rig, we have links down in the description for both the budget build and our baseline build, just in case you're interested in either one. And please make sure that you just go over to robitech.com/builds or just browse our YouTube channel. There are a ton of builds that more than likely are gonna fit the criteria you need. At the end of the day, when we looked at our data and the experiences with both the baseline system and our budget build, both the systems that we talked about were more than capable of driving some of the latest OLED super ultrawide monitors in the market. But we'll talk more about those being the monitors in a later video. And if it's already there, you can actually check out the link right here. In the meantime, we wanna know what you think. Are you interested in the world of ultrawide monitors? Because they're really fun to pet. Did this video help answer your questions? Are there more questions that you have about super ultra-wide monitors? If so, let us know down in the comments below. And if maybe your questions might get answered in our next video if you put the comments in fast enough. And while you're down there, why don't you go ahead and slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post a video like this right here on Robitech. Also, if you have further questions about monitors, hardware, what builds to put, head on over to our Discord server, discord.gg/Robitech. Amazing, I do mean amazing place to go and have conversations with other like-minded PC and tech enthusiasts who love to talk about these things. And who knows, you might make a friend. Also, you can follow me at Robitech absolutely everywhere. Always reach out to me on Twitter or whatever, and maybe I'll have a chance to answer your questions. We also want to give a huge shout out to Asus, Gigabyte, MSI, and Samsung for providing us with some of their super ultra-wide monitors to test with. We can't wait to talk about what's next and reviewing more of the monitors here in the future. Thank you so much for watching this video, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one.